150 strike or air-to-air sorties per day, with at its surge levels the ability to deliver 900 precision-guided munitions every day and reloadable every night.
So even though China now has the largest navy in the world, they don't have anything like this in terms of aircraft carriers.
They do not, but they're working towards it. And they have two operational aircraft carriers right now.
That's China's two diesel-fueled carriers to the U.S.'s 11 nuclear-powered ones that can carry a total of about 1,000 attack aircraft, more than the navies of every other nation on Earth combined.
I'll tell you this, we are here to stay, right, in the South China Sea and in this part of the world. And I think that's the message that we really want to convey to not only China, but the entire world. We will sail wherever international law allows.
Lieutenant Commander David Ash flies an F-18.
Do you get briefed on China's growing military threat and the progress that their Navy is making?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely we do. And they are making great progress in a lot of key areas.
The Chinese are,
from a military standpoint.
This video from Weapons Systems Officer Lieutenant Commander Matthew Carlton shows his F-18 strafing ground targets with a machine gun on a U.S. weapons range near Guam. The pilots on the Nimitz also conduct air-to-air combat or dogfighting drills daily.
How aggressive has China become in the air?
Aggressive. And just some examples include unsafe, unprofessional intercepts where they move within single digits of feet of other aircraft, flashing the weapons that they have on board to the aircrew of the other aircraft, operating in international airspace, maneuvering their aircraft in such a way that denies the ability to turn in one direction. If they're safe and professional, then there's no problem. Everybody has the right to fly and sail wherever international law dictates.
But the Chinese are pushing that.
They are pushing it.
China's increasingly aggressive moves in the Western Pacific, encroaching on territory, illegal fishing, and building bases in the middle of the South China Sea, have pushed nations like Japan and the Philippines to forge closer military ties to the U.S. And this past week, Britain, the U.S., and Australia signed a landmark deal to jointly develop nuclear-powered attack submarines to patrol the Pacific. This is how China and Taiwan appear on most maps. This is how the Chinese Communist Party sees the Western Pacific, including the South and East China Seas from Beijing. Taiwan is the fulcrum in what China's leaders call the First Island Chain, a constellation of U.S. allies that stretches across its entire coast. Control of Taiwan is the strategic key to unlocking direct access to the Pacific and the sea lanes where about 50% of the world's commerce gets transported.
China has accused the United States of trying to contain them. What do you say to China?
I would say, do you need to be contained? Are you expanding? Are you an expansionist power? To a very great extent, the United States was the champion for China's rise. And in no way are we seeking to contain China. What we are seeking for them to play by the rules.
China's Navy, a branch of the People's Liberation Army, is now the world's largest. China is also using its 9,000-mile coastline to rewrite the rules of fighting at sea, as these images from Chinese state media show. Its military has invested heavily in long-range, precision-guided weapons, like the DF-21 and DF-26, that can be used to target ships. China's People's Liberation Army Rocket Force calls them carrier killers, and has practiced shooting them at mock-ups of American ships in the desert that look a lot like the Nimitz.
Since the United States has been operating in the Western Pacific, China's backyard, they've been developing missiles to attack our assets, haven't they? Specific missiles.
Absolutely, yes. First, I'll say the United States is also a Western Pacific nation. So
Guam.
It's not China's backyard.